Good evening. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this week's Live with Bucky Live. We are excited to have you join us tonight. Today, we are actually going to be talking about a really awesome topic, and that is our learning communities. So learning communities are actually embedded within various of our halls and our residential spaces that bring together faculty and staff and students around a specific focus. So during this live Q&A, we'll get a chance actually to hear directly from the faculty directors, the staff, and actually a student is here with us as well, which is very exciting. So we're going to be answering your questions live. So that means if you have anything that you would like to know about learning communities, you know, kind of what they are, who's enrolled in them, how you enroll in them, or anything else, feel free to drop your questions in the live comment section of this video, and we will get to them shortly. So I also wanted to take a moment and mention that if you would like to watch a replay of this live stream after it's over or any of our other Live with Bucky Live sessions, be sure to check out our Live with Bucky Live page at go.wisc.edu/liveWithBuckyLive. We're getting together every single Thursday at 5:30 p.m. to talk about a whole variety of topics. Next week, we're actually going to have staff inside our dorm rooms, showing you an inside view. You can see what the furniture looks like, what the rooms look like, and all of that. So trust me, this is one live stream you won't want to miss. So it'll be a great opportunity to see how many pizzas we can fit in a freezer, which is a really big popular topic. So before we dive into any questions, let's start with some introductions so you can see who we have with us today. So first, I will introduce myself. Hello, my name is Sarah, and I am part of the marketing and communications team here at University Housing. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Cindy.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us tonight. My name is Cindy Holtzman. I work with the Residence Life Department at UW-Madison, and I work in an area that we call residential education. So I work with the learning communities, all the staff you're going to meet tonight. And in addition, I work with our tutoring services, our advising partnerships on campus, and a number of academic supports for students. Stephen, I'm going to hand it over to you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Stephen Wong. I'm the assistant director of Chadbourne Residential College. We are one of two all-building learning communities, which means that if you live in Chadbourne Hall, you're part of our learning community. Our focus is a little bit more of an anti-focus in that we're about exploring the values of a liberal arts education, regardless of your academic background. In both our seminar and in our events, we've got loads of fun while developing ideas and plans to be an engaged, responsible global citizen. Whether you're majoring in African American studies or zoology, you've got a home with us, and we can't wait to work with you to build your vision for your time at Wisconsin. And with that, I'm gonna hand it off to Sari.
Hi, I'm Sari Judge, and I'm the program coordinator with the Startup Learning Community. And the Startup Learning Community is here for students, regardless of major, that have a project of some sort. It may be a business, it may be a nonprofit, it may be a movement that they want to get started. But regardless of your intended major, and we have engineering, computer science, business, English, French literature, name a major, they've lived in startup. Regardless of what your academic focus is, if you've got something that you want to get going, we're here to connect you with all of the resources on campus via our seminar, via our programs, via our events that are going to kickstart your idea and bring it to life while you're here at UW. And now I'll hand it off to Whitney.
Hi, friends. My name is Whitney, and I'm the program coordinator of Open House, meaning I work directly with and for students within the community in providing resources, advocacy, and support. Open House is an inclusive community where LGBTQ plus and allied students can find and create an environment of awareness, respect, and advocacy for all genders and sexualities. Our co-sponsoring academic department is Gender and Women's Studies, and our seminar topics change from semester to semester, and some previous course topics include queer science fiction, queer biographies, queer activism, and much more. Students join us from all different academic focuses and majors to create an interdisciplinary, inclusive, and intentional community for LGBTQ plus and allied folks. And now I will pass it to Jacqueline.
Thank you very much, Whitney. I am Jacqueline, the Program Coordinator for the Women in Science and Engineering, or WISE, Learning Community. We are a group of around 140 undergraduates housed in Elizabeth Waters Residence Hall and funded through a partnership with Housing, the College of Engineering, and the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences. Through WISE, our residents have the opportunity to connect with female faculty, professors, and older undergraduates in the STEM fields. Some highlights of the program are our peer mentors and the weekly WISE seminar that is run by our faculty co-directors. I'll now pass on the microphone to Nirali, our student panelist.
Nirali, I'm the Learning Community Programming Assistant for the Multicultural Learning Community, which is also referred to as the MLC. The MLC is a learning community where students that are interested in multiculturalism, different types of diversity, social justice, and that have an interest in exploring their identity and to learn and experience during their first year of college. So we integrate support for students with an academic seminar that takes place roughly once a week, and it also counts towards students' ethnic studies requirement, which is pretty neat. And so the students have a regular schedule of social and enrichment activities. We combine social, cultural, and academic development to support and develop an understanding of social justice and the skills to become an engaged community member. Some of our activities consist of social justice speakers, Friday night game nights, Tea Tuesdays, where we discuss trending topics, and Self-Care Sunday. We're looking forward to a year where we are not virtual, hopefully, and where we can actually have in-person field trips. And yeah, I'm so excited to answer any questions that you might have.
Well, as you guys can see, we've got a great panel of people here to answer any questions that you might have. So just a reminder, if you have any question about learning communities that you would like to know, just drop it into the comment section of this live video and we will get to it as soon as we can. If by chance we don't get to your question today, or honestly, you just think of something after the session has ended, you can still reach out to us. So please go to our contact form, which you can find on our website at go.wisc.edu/housing-contact, and you'll actually be able to choose what topic you want to talk about. So you'll just go ahead and let us know you have questions about our learning communities. So with that, I actually am just going to hand it over here to Cindy for a real quick overview of kind of what a learning community is.
Thanks, Sarah. Yeah, so if you're still trying to get your head wrapped around what exactly is this learning community thing. So they are located in a specific residential area. So it's a floor, a wing. You heard Stephen mention that Chadbourne Residential College is a whole building. So the sizes vary. And the students participate in the learning community based on shared interest in what the theme or the focus is. And you heard some of those in the introductions, multiculturalism, entrepreneurship, sustainability. We have 11 different learning communities, so I encourage you to check out all the different themes that we have there. There really is something that fits with every single major. It's really not about the major so much as it is an interest in what the focus or the topic is. And then this focus is the basis around which the learning community creates a special class that's exclusive to learning community students and a whole bunch of extracurricular activities, field trips, neat kind of opportunities, again, that kind of get you behind the scenes into a lot of things that this great campus has to offer. So the learning community program is for 1 year, but the benefits really do last much longer as students maintain those friendships and also continue to reap the benefits of internships, research positions, and other kind of academic opportunities that come from those faculty connections that are really solidified in the learning community. So again, some of the specific benefits. There are exclusive special events that expose you to a lot of things that maybe are sometimes hard to come by in this large campus. There are courses that are only available to learning community students. All of the learning communities are affiliated with schools and colleges around campus, so they're really tied to your academic experience, and they're all led by UW-Madison faculty. As again, they are open to students of any major. It's really more about what sounds interesting to you than a major. And for those of you that are exploring, you are welcome to explore your future career major. In fact, a learning community is great for that because we'll put things right in front of you and sort of really help you explore a wide variety of opportunities. And your level of involvement is totally up to you throughout the year. Obviously, your academics and coursework always comes first. So for a little more than $1 a day, the learning communities really offer a significant investment on your return. And it is a nationally recognized high impact practice that we know has good benefits to students. One of the best ways to learn about learning communities is to hear from the students that have lived in them. We have one student panelist, but we wanted you to hear from a few other students. So we're going to share a little video right now that you can hear from some of the students.
It really is a community because we live together, we go to events together. You walk to seminar with a group of friends, you walk back, you have dinner with them.
Whatever you are, wherever you come from, everyone is just accepted and you feel the love. Everyone's brand new, you're not the only one, don't feel alone. You're gonna find someone that you like, even if it's in class, in your dorm or not. And learning communities make that job a little bit easier.
It's just a great way for you to just skip those first steps that usually are the most scared ones. I learned a lot just sitting at the den, studying with my friends, stuff that I haven't learned in the lecture when I should have.
Don't worry if you have no idea or what you're going to do. Think about what you're interested in, and that's where you can pick like a learning community based on that. And that's when you start to see more opportunities related to that.
We're all so close. We can talk about anything. We hang out. We have like a lot of events that we go to. It's just like a lot of fun.
You got to secure your room, which I thought was super nice because that gets that anxiety about where you're going to end up out of the way.
They were always there to help me with any problem I had.
I'm friends with basically everyone on my floor, and I think that really helps because coming from Hong Kong, coming so far away, but when I got to Bradley, it felt like home right away, and that was really comforting.
I got to come to school and unpack and go to this programming room that was full of potatoes. And then I went up a floor and there was literally a full greenhouse full of plants and things growing.
You have the opportunity to work with faculty and also upperclassmen, which is really helpful in like learning what their experiences were and learning the ropes, figuring out how to be a college student.
Freshman year has a lot of information and a lot of things that they throw at you, and that can be pretty overwhelming. So I would definitely, for incoming students, advise over the summer, take some time to look at what's going on your freshman year and think about, okay, what do I think I'm really interested in?
It's the best decision I've ever made because you're making a big university smaller and more intimate.
So we're going to start taking your questions very soon. I know one question is, so how do I join one of these learning communities? It's very simple. It's all part of the housing process. If you return your housing contract by May 1st and in the MyUW housing portal, you'll fill in your interest in which learning communities are you most interested in. You get to rank them. And then there's another question where we say, are you more interested in your learning communities or are you most interested in the traditional residence halls that you ranked? So you want to just let us know that the learning communities are your top choice. A couple of the learning communities might ask you for one or two other pieces of information, but it's all through that MyUW housing portal. And again, it has nothing to do with your major, school, college, anything like that. We won't be looking at that information.
Thanks a lot, Cindy. So I hope that that kind of gave everyone a flavor of what these learning communities are all about. But again, the best way to do that is talk to our panelists. So you guys have questions rolling in and we're just going to jump right into those. So I actually am going to have Stephen answer this first question. And then I think I'll jump to Cindy for a second question. So Stephen, one of the questions that we have is, are learning communities for freshmen only? Can you help add a little light to that?
That's an excellent question, and I'm happy to add what I have for that. Are the residential learning communities at UW-Madison are mostly first-year students, but we welcome students of really any age and grade level to be in our halls. We actually really like it when we do have returning students to learning communities because they add to that atmosphere of helping out your fellow student. There are two exceptions to the to that sort of non-rule, I suppose you would say. Business Connect Learning Community is designed for only first-year direct admit business students. So if that applies to you, then that learning community becomes an option. And then the other all first-year learning community is the Bradley Learning Community. So this one is really, really focused in on that first-year transition. A lot of people going through the same sorts of things, trying to navigate UW-Madison. It's an awesome community for first-year students to gather. But that said, those are the only two that are really only designed for first-year students, but all of our other learning communities would welcome returning students as well.
Thanks a lot, Stephen. So you do have to live in our halls in order to be a part of our learning communities, but we welcome any of our undergraduates to live with us. So that's really great. The second question I'm actually going to bring Cindy back in here for. So Cindy, this question is kind of about engineering. And I'm wondering probably maybe when you're done, I'll look at my panelists down here and see if anyone wants to raise their hand and add anything. But this question comes to us from Bruce. And Bruce is asking, what percentage of incoming freshmen engineering students get into the engineering learning community? So we don't have a specific engineering learning community. So maybe you can kind of help Bruce figure out where might be a good fit.
Absolutely. So you did hear us talk about the Women in Science and Engineering program, which is a great option for students who identify that way. And then engineering students, male engineering students, live in a variety of places. They do have really good representation in our learning communities. I would say engineering is one of the majors that seems to get involved in a lot of things and really seek out opportunities on campus. So we have quite a few. Chadbourne is a popular option. The Bradley Learning Community is popular because we have a faculty fellow from engineering who joins in the Bradley courses. And I know Startup has had engineering students, the studio. So there's really a wide variety of choices. I would encourage you to kind of look into what are the classes like, what are the activities like to see what interests you. And I don't have specific percentages, but overall about 20 to 25% of our incoming freshman students live in the learning communities each year.
Thanks, Cindy. I'm just going to take a peek here at our panelists. Is there anything else any of the other experts want to add? Okay, then I'm going to move along here to our next question. So this one is actually for Jack. So Jack, we're going to bring back you here. So this question comes to us from Jane, and Jane is asking, if a student is in the College of Letters and Science, can they join WISE?
Thank
you. Can you remind us what the criteria are?
I sure can. So it's been touched on broadly, but WISE specific is you don't need to be in any particular college. I know that could be a little confusing because I mentioned the two colleges that help fund the program, but we accept students from any major. You don't even have to be majoring in a STEM field if it's a passion that you have and just want to be involved with that and with other students that have a passion for it, you're welcome to apply as well. So there is no requirement that you cannot join, and we hope that you would give it some thought.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Jack. So again, we encourage people, follow your passion, and your major inherently will fit where it needs to go. That's something we see consistently, which is really cool. For the next question here, I'm going to bring Cindy back. So Cindy, we have a question from Ram, and Ram is asking, is there a specific cost associated with a learning community? How is it related to the residence hall? So can you clarify that a little bit?
Absolutely. So the learning communities are an option within the residence halls, right? And if you choose to live on that particular floor or wing, you are choosing in to the learning community program, and you'll have all of those benefits. Our residence hall costs, you can look at those on our website. It does vary. You do pay a little bit more for certain rooms based on amenities. Some of the larger rooms, or if the bathroom setup is different, newer construction. So there's a variety of costs that you're seeing on the screen now that are associated with the room. So that's sort of the starting point. The additional cost for the learning community is just that $200 to $250 a year, which is billed each semester. So if for any reason you don't continue, it wouldn't be billed the following semester. But as I mentioned, that's really like a dollar a day. And that's what pays for the additional staff and activities and sort of special experiences that we're able to create in the learning communities.
Thanks a lot, Cindy. I think that clarification is super duper helpful. So actually our next question, I'm gonna bring in Nirali. So Nirali, we have a question from Annika. And Annika is asking, is it hard to get into some learning communities? Can we put a second or third choice?
Yeah, so as a reminder, I work for the MLC. And so you are able to put down a second or a third choice. And so a really great thing about the MLC is that we try our hardest not to, for lack of better words, reject or deny someone from joining our learning community. And so something that we did this year was we had a lot of applicants, and because we didn't want to turn away anyone from living or being a part of the multicultural learning community, we actually we transitioned from a smaller wing into a bigger wing so that we could fit all of our residents. And so we could have everyone who wanted to be a part of the MLC be a part of it this year.
Thanks a lot, Nirali. And I'm actually going to bring Cindy back in here just to remind us about how that preference process works. So again, you have that ability to rank more than one, and MLC is a great choice, but how does that work again?
Yep. On the MyUW housing portal, you'll be asked to rank learning communities, and there will be a separate ranking for traditional residence halls. And in the learning community preferences, you can absolutely list more than one. So it is great to explore a second or a third choice. I love to hear that people are thinking ahead and thinking there's more than one of these that might sound interesting, because really they are some wonderful things in each of the programs. So that's great to think about. And then after you rank the learning communities and the halls, another page is going to automatically pop up. You don't need to remember this. Well, it'll all be in the portal. But another page will pop up and will ask you, okay, so you ranked both of these. Which is most important to you, the learning community or the traditional hall? And I know some people are probably wondering about roommates. We do ask, whether you're in a learning community or a traditional hall, anywhere, we ask that you and your roommate rank those things the same way, because if you don't, it really is confusing to us. If you and your roommate want to share a room, then you need to be in the same residence hall or in the same learning community program. So that's something to talk to them about. And in a couple more weeks, we're going to have a Live with Bucky Live, and we're going to talk about roommates and talk about how many of people go with a random roommate and life turns out just fine. So that is something you want to communicate with your roommate about if you've already decided who that person will be.
That's good advice, Cindy. I'm actually going to bring Steven back in here. So we've got a question kind of about Bradley Learning Community versus Chadbourne. And I think this is a good one for you. So this comes to us from M. And M is asking, what is the vibe of the Bradley Learning Community and how does it compare to Chadbourne?
Oh, the vibe question. So the vibes, I would say, are pretty similar, because in each of the learning communities, you're going to have a really solid core of staff who are excited to work with you, who are excited to sort of see what you want to make happen in the learning community. And you'll get that either place. I think if there are some differences, it's going to be Bradley is in the Lakeshore community or Lakeshore neighborhood, which is a wonderful fit for lots of people. And then Chadbourne is in the Southeast neighborhood, which is also a wonderful fit for lots of people. I think it's going to kind of depend on what it is that you might specifically be looking for. If I were to say sort of anything else about that, yeah, what they're doing right now is scrolling through. That's the other thing that Bradley has done really solidly, is they have tons of faculty who are involved. So the people who are teaching your classes would also be around the community. Not something that we're sort of working to still develop, but both communities would be excellent options, mostly because the staff who you'd be around and who are making it run really are looking out for the best for what your experience would be.
Thanks a lot, Stephen. I can attest, honestly, both communities are awesome and are really great choices. So if you're looking for ones with lots of events going on that have connections, you really, honestly, you kind of win. You can't go wrong. All right. So it looks like we have a question here for Sari, and let me just find it here. I had it a second ago, and of course, oh, here it is. Wait, sorry. Let's see if my colleague finds it before me. I'm actually going to go to Cindy here first because I can't find it here in the list. So we're going to have Cindy come back. And actually, Emma has a question here about figs. So I think it's a good opportunity to talk about what a fig is. So Emma is asking, if you want to do figs, is it realistic to do both figs and learning communities? Or do you recommend choosing to stick with one? So Cindy, could we start by kind of talking about what a fig is compared to an LC?
Absolutely. And I love that Emma has obviously already figured out what a FIG is. So FIG stands for Freshman Interest Group, and it's a set of classes. You take three classes together, and a couple of them are sort of your traditional classes that you would be taking anyhow. You know, usually English is one of them, or some of these other sort of gen ed requirements. And then the FIG course sort of ties it all together. So there's themes. And if you look at those, they have a fabulous website where you can see all of their themes, and I see it's being pulled up there. If you look at their themes and then you look at the themes for our learning communities, you might see some crossover. Although in a given semester, they have 60 or 70 figs, so they have a lot more to pick from. And again, almost all of them are open to any major. A couple of them are major specific. And I work closely with these colleagues on campus. And no, it is definitely not too much. In fact, I would say, you know, this is a large campus. There are wonderful, wonderful resources for you here. That's one of the benefits of a big campus. But it can be hard sometimes to figure out how do you create your path through this large place. And that's why the learning communities and the FIGs and the honors programs, all of these programs are really designed to, you know, help narrow those things down and help you explore and help you figure out the right path for you. And they really work complementary. The FIGs, you know, that's 12 credits. So that would be most of your classes. And then you would squeeze in the learning community class, which is usually another credit or two. But the FIGs are really about what you're doing in class. And then the learning communities are really about the sort of extracurricular activities. So we've had plenty of learning community students that did both, because the learning communities do tend to appeal to those students who, you know, in high school, you were the honor students, you were in the National Honor Society, you were in different clubs, you know, you want to make the most of this experience at UW-Madison. And I'd say, you know, taking on a couple of different things is definitely not too much. And as I said, for the learning communities, your involvement is always up to your own choice. So if you're having a hectic week, we will definitely understand. Nobody's going to make you go to a movie night or anything.
So Emma, I say go for it. Live it up, right? Do both. Why not? You only get to experience it once, so go for it. So thanks, Cindy. I did find our question here for Sari. So Sari, I'm bringing you in here. So this question is from Ron Veer. And they are asking, are there any inter-community events or competitions? I know Startup has been connected with some. Can you kind of give some examples of things that have been going on?
It's a great question, Ron Veer, and the answer is yes and yes. And I'll talk to two of them. As far as inter-community events, a perfect example is Startup partners with the studio and the greenhouse every February for an event called Project Thrift, where we take students that are interested in competing. It's kind of a greener version of Project Runway. We go shopping for thrifted clothing, and then we have folks on hand that teaches everyone how to craft what it was that they got from the thrift shop into some sort of sustainable fashion. We've got music. It's a fantastic party, and we always do that. Startup, the studio, which is the creative arts and design community, and Greenhouse, which is the sustainability-focused learning community. And that's just one example of sponsored events and partnered events that happen in learning communities all over campus. As far as competitions go, we also host a competition for the entire campus, but we have lots of learning community participation, and it's called the 100 Hour Challenge. And it is essentially an opportunity to take either a list of items that we provide to you or the chance to go shopping in kind of a thrifted cast off item environment. And then students have 100 hours to fashion their items into some sort of new product, which you then pitch via video. And we have, it is open to all students at on UW-Madison's campus, but it's housed at Startup and housed in the learning communities. And we love when first year students participate. And there's big prize money associated with it. So be on the lookout next year.
Thanks a lot, Sari. You guys are always doing such innovative stuff. So what Sari talked about, this happens all over our learning communities. So thanks a lot. So I'm actually going to go to Maggie's Music. She has a question and also the most awesome handle. So I'm going to give them a shout out for that. So Maggie's Music is asking this question. I'm going to have Whitney handle. Is there gender separation within the learning communities? If so, how does this work?
Yeah, Maggie, thanks for that awesome question. So the great thing about learning communities and also, you know, university housing as a whole is that folks from all genders live throughout our learning communities and throughout our halls, right? And so that's an awesome, beautiful thing. I also wanted to mention that for our queer and trans folks looking for, and maybe have questions about like, how do I make sure that my room assignment is affirming and inclusive to me and my identities. Our awesome folks and colleagues in the assignments office within University Housing work really closely with students. And so if you wanna reach out to them, they will definitely make sure that you are, again, assigned to a housing assignment that feels safe and affirming to you. And then also I see my colleague has the gender inclusive housing website pulled up. And so that will be located, it's a floor located in Merritt Hall. Think open house in that, you know, for queer and trans and allied students, but without the learning community added aspect of open house. So definitely explore the gender inclusive housing community, again, in Merritt Hall, and then also open houses in the Phillips Hall.
Thanks a lot, Whitney. So I'm going to try to squeeze in a couple more questions here before we end. So I'm just going to jump as fast as I can here. So Nirali, we've got a question for you. So this is from Alberto, and Alberto is wondering, if we want to join a language floor, which is related to the cultural community, are there additional steps or forms we need to fill out?
Yeah, thanks for your question, Alberto. So it sounds like you might have learned about the language floors from the housing website or someone who's lived on it. And so actually the multicultural learning community does not have language floors. The learning community that does though is the international learning community that is located in Adams Hall. And so we can, yeah, provide some information on that. So that's a separate learning community from the MLC. And it's definitely possible to get involved with this learning community. And so they have different languages and different floors that allow for students to have activities and more understanding of those languages. Some of them include like Mandarin, Spanish, French, Japanese, and so definitely possible to get involved with them.
That's great, Nirali. Thank you. And I do know that the Language House apps are now open on our website, I believe. So you're able to go ahead and do that. And you can also do it in your housing portal. So we've got time here for just about one more question, a couple here. So I'm actually going to see if we can squeeze it in. We've got a question from Annika. And Annika is asking, what is the deadline if there is one to apply? So Cindy, would you be able to just go over deadlines again for us?
Absolutely. So the deadline for your housing contract is May 1st, and that's the same deadline for the learning community preferences. So through that MyUW housing portal, you complete all the steps of your contract, and that's where you do the preferences that I talked about. So just May 1st, it's the same deadline. It's the deadline deciding to come to school here. We know there's a lot for you to consider, so we tried hard not to make it an earlier deadline for folks. So when you're ready to say that you want to be a Badger next year, then turn in your housing contract and your learning community preferences as well.
That's awesome. Well, I just want to take a moment and thank everyone for joining us today. That wraps up our session on learning communities. However, if you are dying to know more about our learning communities, there's a couple ways you can get to know more. One, be sure you fill out our contact us form that you can find at go.wisc.edu/housing-contact, and we will get any question that you need or have or want to know about, we'll get that answered. The other way is, actually, we are holding another Learning Community live stream on April 22nd. So mark your calendars or watch your email, and we'll be sending that out. Also, I do know that admissions is doing some upcoming sessions about learning beyond the classroom, where with admissions that'll be talking about FIGS and honors questions. So that could be a place too where you could submit some questions about learning communities. Otherwise, it has been awesome having you guys here with us today. It's really exciting to see you all excited about coming to live with us. And we can't tell you how excited we are to welcome you back to campus. Just a reminder, if you would like to watch a replay of this or other live stream sessions, be sure to join us at our website with liveWithBucky, go.wisc.edu/liveWithBuckyLive. Otherwise, we will look forward to seeing you next Thursday at 5:30, where we're going to peek inside our dorm rooms. So thanks a lot, you guys, and have an awesome evening.